Okay, itħalti akwata.
Okay, thank you. So good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all. See you on the screen. And what we will do, we will continue what we did a few weeks ago when we started about the issues of halakha, kehila, and yachid, and moderna, which was basically a combination of, we will talk about different cases, where the balance or the tension between the individual, the community, the halakha, modernity, standards, all sorts of things comes together, and the posek needs to make some decisions. So last week we started with allowing people or to quote unquote present them some kind of an opportunity where they can commit a sin because of us. We spoke about opening up a restaurant which sells non-kosher or sells meat on the Tishat Hayamim and things like that. And that's what we did last week. I just want to finish up with one more source regarding the prior issue and to start with the new issue, which will be not less interesting like the other one. I mean, it will be not less, it will be even more. Let's just see the source sheet and we'll go from there. I just want to just say one more thing. Another thing to have in mind when we come and make psika, that's the Shut Chatam Sofer, Rabbi Moshe Sofer from the 18th century. And as you know, Rabbi Moshe Sofer, who basically can be suspicious in being a liberal or reform, he says the following: Vayen Eruvin, Kaf Alef Amud Bet, B'sha'a she'tiken Shlomo Eruvin v'netilat Yadayim. So when Shlomo, King Solomon, enacted or decreed or invented the idea of Eruvin and washing of your hands, Yatzta bat kol ve'amra, so a heavenly voice came out and said, Im chacham bni, if my son is smart, ismach libi gam ani, I also will rejoice. V'ikshat tosfot, hagam shniot tiken. So the Rabbi Chatam Sofer asks a very good question. He says, I don't understand. The Gemara says that what? That Shlomo HaMelech created two decrees. One, and the other one is Netilat Yadayim. And for that, God says, wow, you are a very smart son, and I'm rejoicing in what you do. But Tosfot asks a question. He says, just one second. But King Solomon, according to the Masoret, also created another decree, which was Shniyot Le'arayot. What is Shniyot Le'arayot? So you know, in the Torah, we have Arayot. We have women. Most of them are family-related women that we are not allowed to be with them. So Shlomo HaMelech expanded the parsha and basically added what we call Shniyot La'arayot. If you want to have a list, you can look at Gemara in Yevamot. So Tosfot says, why that enactment Hashem did not praise? So says the Chatam Sofer, V'yesh lomar lefi hanal b'meh shehosif chumra le'isur shniyot, because he added this chumra and he said that women who are even second degree family relatives, af al gav shehu mitzvah la'asot siag la'torah, even though there is a mitzvah to create a fence to the Torah so people don't violate the core values, mikol makom lo shayach ismach libi, but God cannot be really happy. Why? Ki ulai ikashlu baze bnei adam she'einam hagunim. Because sometimes people who are not that decent might commit a sin. And so before King Solomon created what he created, so then if you violated it, it's not a violation because there was no issur. But now after Shlomo HaMelech created an issur, a prohibition, if people who are indecent or undecent or not decent going to violate it, they're going to want to violate a prohibition. So basically, what do we have? Aval kesheasa siyag leshmirat Shabbat v'gam asa tikun shelo yikalkelu bo. But when he did a fence for Shabbat, and he also created a way to overcome it, which eruvin, haynu sheyarvu eruvin az ismach libi gam ani. Chatam Sofer is telling us something which is incredible, really, in the process of halacha. He says, look, Shlomo HaMelech created three enactments: Eruvin, נטילת ידיים, אין שניות לעריות. Everyone understand what is שניות לעריות? Just nod your head that I know that you are with me. Okay. שניות לעריות, meaning we have, according to the Torah, again, first degree family relatives that you are not allowed to be with them. Shlomo HaMelech expanded it to second degree relatives, like, you know, cousins, the daughter of the woman that your father raped, all sorts of things, what's called שניות לעריות. So the Gemara says that God praised him for only two, for Eiruvin and Netilat Yadayim, but he didn't praise him for שניות לעריות. Question, why not? Says Rabbi Moshe Sofer, I'll tell you why. Because with שניות לעריות, which obviously tried to avoid sexual inappropriate behavior, was a problem. Why? Because he just created a prohibition. He didn't create a way to overcome it. And when he created this prohibition, some people who cannot control themselves will violate it. So therefore, yes, he made the decree, but God is not happy. I'm not saying God is upset, but God is not happy. Now you will ask, but just one second. When he created the idea of Eruvin, he also created the prohibition of moving things in the Chatzer. So why God was happy with that? So answer, says Rabbi Moshe Sofer, because Shlomo HaMelech also provided us with what? With a solution. So a posek cannot just bring a prohibition and that's it. You also need to offer what? A solution. So in conclusion, before we go to the next topic, which is somewhat connected, it seems to be that when we talk about prohibitions, things to take into consideration in the halachic process, you need to know how your decree will affect people, but not only people. We are talking about also anashim she'eina mehuganim. What is anashim she'eina mehuganim? People who are not decent, people who are not going to be so observant. And when we make a decree, we need to take them into consideration, which is an amazing thing. Our enactment, our decrees are not necessarily only for the tzaddikim, but they are also, or maybe we need to take into consideration, people who are not as pious or as righteous as we think. So that's what Rabbi Moshe Sofer said. And this is obviously has tremendous ramifications to almost every decree that we do. Unfortunately, today, you know, in today's world, people make decrees or enactments or siyagim, and they don't really take into consideration the entire population. So now let's see another topic, which I think you will be very surprised. And the topic is as follows. So now we are going to talk about itarvut keilatit ve'achrayut keilatit. When do we as a community need to intervene and what is our responsibility? So Rabbi Yitzchak ve'Rabbi Moshe Arama wrote a very interesting book. It's called Akeidat Yitzchak. And he lived in the 15th century in Spain. And at that time in Spain, Jews were obligated to sit in Christian lectures in churches. So he also created some kind of a very attractive drashot and to try to what? To influence the Jews. So that was the question that came to his doorsteps. וכמה פעמים נתחבטתי על זה. He says, many times I was questioning it, or I had doubts on the following question. What's the following question? על אודות הנשים הקדשות שהיה איסורן רופף ביד שופטי ישראל אשר בדורנו. ולא עוד, אלא שכבר יאותו בקצת הקהילות, ליתן להם חנינה ביניהם. גם יש שמפסיקים להם פרס מהקהל, כי אמרו, כיוון שמצילות את הרווקים או השחלים מחטא איסור אשת איש החמור, או מסכנת הגויות, מוטב שיעברו עליו זה, מי שיבואו לידי איסור סקילה או סכנת שריפה. Okay. I am going to take the liberty of interpretation and I will share with you the question he was dealing with, and you think we have problems. 15th century, it's the 15th century, Spain. Jews are under very difficult times. The church is really annoying them and bothering them. And you know, 1492, this is the expulsion from Spain. So he was not there, he was before. But basically you can already feel the pressure. However, in communities, Jewish communities, there are nashim kdeshot. What is nashim kdeshot? This is a very nice word for prostitution. So you have Jewish women who are prostitutes. Okay, I mean, malasot, you know, we always had it. What's the deal? What's the issue? The issue is that in some communities, they are not only just ignoring them, but basically what they do is that they would like to institutionalize their profession in the community. In some communities, says Rabbi Yitzchak Arama, they basically give them a stipend from the funds, from the communal funds, in order to keep them in business. Are you with me? Do you hear the question? Okay. I see some of you are nodding their heads, some of you are smiling. I know, maybe we do say, let's go back to the 15th century. I don't know. But the thing is, so what Rabbi Yitzchak Arama is so shocked, he says, I don't understand. He says, what's their rationale? Because obviously, you're talking about, by the way, Rashei HaKahal, you're not talking about stupid people, you're talking about the leaders of the communities. They basically say, we're going to give them a stipend and we're going to keep them open. Why? So their rationale is, look, first and foremost, and take a look at what he says here. He says, shekvar ye'otu biktzat ha-keilot, that some communities give them chanina b'nehem, chanina meaning chaniya, which they give them a building. They let them smea kahal, that's a stipend. Ki amru, what's their rationale? Ki amru, keivan shematzilot et haravakim ho haschalim michet isur eshet ish hachamur o misakanat hagoyot mutav shiyavru alav ze. He says there are some people who are not that smart, or they are very relaxed with their sexual inclinations. And it's better for them, who are the them, all the others from the Jewish community, to be with the Jewish prostitute and not to what? And not to have an affair with a married woman, or to be with a non-Jewish woman. Why? Because back then, if you read any history of 15th century and even before, if a Jew was caught with a Christian woman, we are talking about death. So therefore, the communities basically suggested, you know what? It's better to have Jewish women who are prostitutes, so it will prevent the guys from having an affair with married women or having relationships with whom? With non-Jewish women, and that can obviously lead to death and to persecutions against the Jewish community. So you know what? We as a community, we will going to take the budget. A line in the budget is Jewish prostitution. Can you imagine a board meeting discussing it? Okay, obviously we have an issue. So the question is that Rabbi Moshe Arama is dealing with is not only if that's allowed or not, but here you have a communal intervention in something that it's obviously not something that we like, but the community, at least the leaders of that community, thought that that's the best idea ever. And that's going to save those people who cannot control themselves. Now that's an interesting thing. We have two interesting things here. The first thing is that we realize that we cannot, that we failed educationally. Jewish men, I'm not saying the pious ones, but I guess it was to such an extent that it's become a phenomena that the leaders of the community felt that they need to do something. So you're talking about more than just one guy or two. I guess it was groups of boys who did it. And what they did caused two issues. A, on the halachic front, if they will have an affair with married women, you are talking about mamzerim, you're talking about isur eshet ish, you're talking about karet, you're talking about so many different things, A. B, on what I will call the interreligious conflict between Judaism and Christianity, they can put themselves and the entire community at risk of the wrath and the rage of the Christian community that a Jew had relationships with a Christian woman. So they decided, because the phenomena, I guess, grew to an extent that they had to do something. So what did they do? They say, okay, you know what? We're going to institutionalize or institute prostitution's homes so the Jewish men will not cause themselves too much of a harm. Rabbi Yitzchak Arama was furious. And he says, what are you talking about? He said, ואני דנתי על זה פעמים רבות לפניהם ולפני גדוליהם. Do you see this thing, this testimony? This testimony basically say what? It says, I already talked about it many times, פעמים רבות, in front of the communities, because he would go and give a drasha in different communities. ולפני גדוליהם, and in front of their leaders and rabbis. Meaning he tried to convince them, but they didn't really listen. והסברתי להם, and I explained to them, שהחטא הגדול אשר יעבור עליו איש איש מבית ישראל בסתר, ושלא לדעת הרבים וברשות בית דין, חטאת יחיד הוא. והוא שבעוונו ימות על ידי בית דין של מעלה, או מטה, וכל ישראל נקים פילגש בגבעה, אם היו בית דין שלהם מוסרים האנשים הרשעים ההם לבדם ביד ישראל. רבי יצחק הרמה says many times that even if a Jew committed a terrible sin, terrible transgression, but he did it privately, he did it, people did not know about it. It was not communalized. So he will get what he deserved. But it's nothing to do with the community. Omnam, החטא הקטן, כשיסכימו עליו דעת הרבים, והדעת ניתנה בבתי דיניהם שלא למחות, however, even if a most minute, small, little sin that was communalized, that was accepted by the community and it's being supported by the community by not rebuking them or by helping them, הנה הוא זימה ואבון פלילי וחטאת הקהל כולו ולא ניתן למחילה אם לא בפורענות הקהל כמו שהיה בבני בנימין על השתתפותם באבון והוא היה אבון סדום כמו שביארנו, שהם ובתי דינים שלהם הסכימו שלא להחזיק יד עני ואביון. I'll stop here for just a second, and we need to analyze what he says. Look at the situation. Communities upon communities helped prostitution to be, I don't want to call it a mainstream in the community, but it was accepted in the community, was not rebuked, and was funded. Rabbi Yitzchak Arama had enough from that. And he went to those communities and he talked to them, but it was like talking to the wall. And he explained to them and he says, look, I understand you have an issue. He's not oblivious to the issue. There are single boys, single Jewish boys who are going to have an affair with a married woman, or they are going to go to a non-Jewish woman. And I understand the issue. But if they do it and they are being caught, okay, so, you know, God will take care of them with a heavenly punishment, or if they're going to be executed by the church, that's their issue. But it does not reflect on the community. And it brings an example. Pilegesh Bagiva. You all remember the story in Tanakh with the concubine that was raped and butchered in Binyamin? You remember that story in Tanakh? Pilegesh Bagiva? Okay. So he says there, if the Beidin will extradite those people who were involved, it was Gamarnu. That's it. It was done because it was not approved by the community. When did the issue started? When Bnei Binyamin, when the entire tribe of Binyamin supported them and went to battle. That's when it became a huge issue. And it says the same thing here. When you have a little sin or a big sin, but when it's become communalized and you support it and you allow them to be in the midst of your community, and when you fund them, you think you are saving them? No. You are putting a disgrace on the entire community. A Jewish community that supports Jewish prostitution? What are you talking about? Oh, so you are saying that there is a halachic consideration. And now this is the point that I want to bring here. When you take Rabbi Yitzchak Arama and you talk the leaders of the, and you take the leaders of this community, what do you have? You have a confrontation, you have a tension between what? Between what I will call a cold halachic calculation. What is the cold halachic calculation? Join me. First thing to consider is love. According to the Torah, there is love of a woman not to be a prostitute. Lo tiye kdesha mi beit Yisrael velo yeh kadesh. Okay? A woman is isur love. There is a negative prohibition for a woman to be a prostitute. Okay. The other side is, if I am not allowing prostitution, there will be isur karet, which is much more severe, isur eshet ish, or death punishment or penalty because a Jew was with a non-Jewish woman. So if I am taking that only as a cold calculation, do you understand the leaders of the community? The answer is yes, for sure. However, Rabbi Yitzchak Arama, what other factor does he bring into the consideration, which he thinks will tilt the scale into not supporting prostitution? What is the consideration he brings?
Public policy.
The what?
Public policy.
Public policy. This is exactly the point of this shiur. Rabbi Yitzchak Arama, Danny, thank you. He basically says, cold calculation is good for the Beit Midrash. You know, if we will sit now in the Beit Midrash Nitzanim, and we're going to ask a question halachically, what's better? So we'll say, look, nothing is better, but we can understand midcheha mikameha. It's a sugiya in Sota, in Daf Mem Daled. If the posek has two issues that both of them are a problem, so he's going to tell the person to go with the least of the severe issue. But here Rabbi Yitzchak Arama says, you don't live on a lonely island. You don't live separate. It's impossible to accept as a public policy that community will channel funds into something that it's asur. It's one thing when an individual comes to you and say, look, Rabbi, I'm this, I'm that, I'm the other. There is one thing. But you can take this heter one-on-one and then to enlarge it to the entire community. There is a public policy that you need to take into consideration in your psak. And the community must intervene, but not like what you decided, but in a different way. So what does he say? He said, velachen, look at this language, velachen, hu tov umutav, it's better and it's good, sheikartu o yisarfu o yisaklu hachataim ahem benafshotam, it's better for those sinners, for those Jewish single men who go to prostitutions or go to Jewish, non-Jewish women, or even have an affair with the Jewish woman, that they should be cut off, burned, or stoned. Mishete'aker ot achad me'atorah behaskamat harabim. Then one word from the Torah will be uprooted or omitted or faded with a communal consent. כמו שאמר בזה שעשתה בו פרשה בפני עצמו לא תהיה קדשה, כמו שהתבאר. ומי שלא יקבל זה בדעתו, and if someone will disagree with me, אין לו חלק בבינה, he has no share in wisdom, ונחלה בתורת אלוקית, and no inheritance in the godly divine Torah. Now, that's become interesting. I don't know, I hope it's interesting. Are you with me? It's just so hard with this Zoom thing. It's not my first time giving a shiur in Zoom, but it's just so hard to see faces. Rabbi Yitzchak HaRama is basically bringing almost a 21st century tension that we deal with it on a daily basis. Daily basis, maybe it's a little bit of a dramatic statement, but on a weekly basis. There is a cold calculation, halachic cold calculation, that might be, say, you are allowed to do it. But then there is the public policy. How people are going to look at it? What do you do when you allowing something and you are basically saying, look, because of the circumstances and also because of the halachic matter, it's better to have a communal consent to something that is not allowed. Now, you can say, and now, Rabbi Yitzchak HaRama, just by the way, was very assertive, I would say, or even a bit aggressive. He says, if you don't agree with me, you have no part in wisdom or in God's inheritance in Torah, which is pretty strong. Basically say, if you don't think like me, you are out of here, okay? But the idea is, and you know, we see some poskim who are saying things like that, and obviously I'm not judging, we are talking about a very difficult circumstances, very difficult time for the Jews, especially in Spain. But we learn from it many things. A, we see that sexual relationships in Spain was somewhat relaxed. Unlike in Ashkenaz, that we see less of inappropriate sexual misconduct or things like that, in Spain, we see definitely much more. We see it even earlier centuries, we see the same thing, the amount of questions that Poskim had with some kind of, sexual relationships that are not exactly approved by the rabbis. So in Spain, we see that the situation is not great. And Rabbi Yitzchak HaRama, again, is not oblivious to it. He says, look, if this Jewish single boy wants to go to a non-Jewish woman or to have an affair with a Jewish woman, you know what? I can't stop him. I can't. But I definitely cannot help him by communally accepting something that is wrong. As an individual, I might. I might take the responsibility upon my shoulders to say, you know what? Mr. X, you know what? I know he's sinning, but you know what? What can I do? But as a community, when you accept it, you are basically omitting a prohibition from the Torah.
But so can I ask a question?
Sure.
Who said, I mean, in other words, I've got to believe that there are also halacha considerations as to why communal funds can't be used for this purpose. You know, I don't understand that it's totally halacha versus community needs. He talks about meat of stone. You know, so I have to believe that there are halachic ramifications of the community doing that.
So the midat Zdom, Jeff, that he used is only to say that in Zdom, the injustice was institutionalized and communalized and formalized by the Batei Din. That's why he used the example of Zdom. He does not talk so much about the money. The money was just to keep the prostitutes walking. But the idea was that that's just like the second tier. The first, the core is when the leaders of the community say, you know what, we know it's not allowed in the Torah. However, there are other considerations. So therefore, we're going to agree with it. And then to agree with that, it's not, doesn't stop there. Then we need to fund it because we need to keep it open. So in a way, it's a very interesting thing. The community did address the needs of individuals. I don't know how many.
That's a key point, though.
I think you're close.
No.
No, you are. You're good.
I'm close?
No, you're good.
Okay, what I was going to say is I happen to be reading a book on this period of time, and what you didn't include is the percentages. The Jewish community was a big source, and it wasn't that you have the story of the rape and killing of the woman, the Pelegish Megiddo, but you had wholesale communal changes over because of the threat of destruction. And at that time, there were people in the community who changed. The chief rabbi of an important town became an important priest, for example, during that period of time. And so the question is, what's the swing point where you say, we'll have to suffer, and if God wants us all dead, burnt, killed, sliced, all the things that were done, to a community that was powerful and at the top, and where the leadership wanted to protect the Jews, but they couldn't from the common people. It's an interesting thing. It's a whole story about economics and power and the ordinary people wanting money from the Jews. It was not a question of religion. Religion was, it was to some point, and it was a cover. So to say it is very nice, but if you're the leadership and you see your whole community being decimated by prostitution, by affairs with women, and the seduction of the Jewish young people, it wasn't, if they're one, two, three, four, that's one thing. But it's thousands. It's very nice to be at Tzadik and Peltz.
Right. So, I will address it. Paul?
Yeah, I've got a related question. Did Yitzhak Rama think that he would succeed? What was his shikul? If he thought he would succeed, kadima. But if he was unsure, what is he doing? He's upsetting his kehila or his community and the community in Spain, and the end result is worse than he started. Okay. But the question is, does the ends justify the means? And we don't have information here.
It's a more right. So we are lacking some information. Phil.
It's a more important thing. The whole community was butchered, it was murdered. And this was an excuse that they had intercourse with a Gentile woman. And so if you look at it, at the big picture, in terms of the perpetuation of the community, Spain had the most conversions of anywhere else. And
right.
Am I right?
No. So the thing is, I'm going to take Phil, what you said, Paul, what you said, and maybe what also other people have on their mind. We are dealing, first and foremost, Rabbi Yitzchak Rama was not known as a posek, he was known as a darshan.
Oh.
The position of a darshan, it's like the Magid Midubna, he needs to highlight wrongs. He cannot go home to have Shabbos lunch and chulent without making you feel bad, okay? That was the style, you know, that was the style. The style is, what do you call it in America, they call it
brimstone?
Yes. You need to, you know, bang on the shtender and you need to get you feel bad and guilty. That's the position of a darshan, okay? So the darshan is not the posek. But also what we see here, and this is where, you know, you have all sorts of consideration that we need to take, especially when you are a posek. And I didn't bring it as a psak, as you see. You know, you look at what I quoted it from, he brings it from Bereshit Shear Kaf. This is his interpretation to the Chumash. Okay, it's not a question. But he went and with people, with the leaders of the community. So now it's true. Rabbi Yitzchak But he says, we know what, we should, our community. You can't hear me? Can you hear me? No? Kacha?
Yes.
כן, רב שהשנייה, אני רציתי להגיד לך קודם, אנחנו שומעים אותך עד עכשיו, אבל תיקח בחשבון שהאינטרנט שלך חלשה, אוקיי? פשוט תשים לב, עד עכשיו זה איכשהו גבולי, אבל אנחנו שומעים אותך. אם זה יחמיר, אז אני אגיד לך. בסדר?
Okay, yeah, because אני על I'm really on my phone. I'm doing like a hotspot.
זה גבולי, אבל זה אפשרי בינתיים. יש טיפה בעיה עם קול, אבל זה עדיין בגבול של סבירות. אבל תשים לב, תעקוף פשוט. אם יקרה משהו, אני אגיד לך.
Okay, toda. So so the thing is that we really have a clash of two worlds of how to look at things. The leaders of the community look at that, feel very much like you. Look, we are going to be under destruction. It's enough for one Jew to be caught with a Christian girl and our community will be vanished. We will be killed, we will be dead, we will be butchered, we will be raped, we will be, I don't know what we will be. And Rabbi Yitzchak Arama says to them, you know what? Okay, whatever. But we as a community cannot and we should not give a consent and to support something that according to the Torah is not allowed. You see, I'm not saying who is right, who is wrong. I just wanted to bring to the front the issue of communal intervention in order to address an issue. And some rabbis and some leaders says, look, we need to address that issue. I understand we are going to violate something from the Torah, but it's in order for us to be alive, to continue our religious life, to continue our legacy, to continue our communities. But some people would say, no, 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 that's not a good way. You are going to basically lemasmes, you are going to basically melt everything that we built for so many years. You're going to dilute Judaism. And then when you start omitting one prohibition, you're going to omit other prohibitions as well, because there is a group here and there is a group there that demands this or demands that. So again, I'm not making a psak here. I just wanted to bring it to the front, as we say in Hebrew, lehatzif, to float, basically issues we all know in the 21st century, we are dealing with it all the time. There are some things that, you know, some groups want A and we as a community needs to address it, needs to accept it, needs to reject it, needs to, it's so many different things that we need to take into consideration. And then he continues on and he says, in Dvarim, he says in his Perush, his interpretation for Dvarim, in Parashat Ki Tetze, when he talks about, century, okay, and so he is in the 15th century, and he says v'zeleshono about lo tiye kedesha mibnot Israel, that a Jewish woman cannot be a prostitute. Ki wazara lebeit din, it's a warning to the court, not to her, not to be a prostitute, but a warning to the court shelo yaniya. פרשת דרכים בעיניים על הדרך לזימה או שתתקן לה קובה של זונות כמנהג ארצות זרים יושבות על הפתח בתופים ובכינורות כל אלו דבריו. So he brings the Ramban and says, look, when the Torah says לא תהיה קדישה מבנות ישראל, that a woman, a Jewish woman, should not be a prostitute, so the simple understanding is what? That the negative prohibition is against a woman. Meaning if a woman, a Jewish woman, decides to be a prostitute, she needs to know that she is violating a negative prohibition. The Ramban, Nachmanides, and Rabbi Yitzchak Arama later on says, no, 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 no. It's not a negative prohibition on the woman. It's a warning to the Beidin. Meaning if I sit on a Beidin, and I hear that Mrs. So-and-so became a prostitute, I need to go knock on her door and tell her, my dear daughter, come back. You cannot be a prostitute. What do you have? Financial issues? We will support you. You have mental issues? We will help you. Whatever issues you have, we're going to take care of it. We cannot allow you to be a prostitute. If that's true, by the way, that's the Ramban interpretation, but if that's true, says Rabbi Yitzchak Arama, for sure in our case, you want to tell me that the courts in those communities not only did not try to rebuke those women and to save them, they are going to what? To pay the money? They're going to communalize it? It makes no sense. And therefore, Rabbi Yitzchak Arama says, ובזה נמלצו דבריו מאוד. במה שביער שלא הוצרח הכתוב, אלא להזהרת בידין, שבכל עיר ועיר שלא יניחו לשום אישה בת ישראל להפקיר עצמה, להושיב קובה של זונות כמנהג הקוטים או העקום, או שום הפקר כלל, והוא נכון מאוד, כי דברים הללו, וכל כיוצא בהן, כשיעשו בפרסום, because all those things that are inappropriate, when they are being done in public, הקולר תלוי על צוואר בית דין. Who is the one to be blamed? The court, the Jewish court, the Jewish leaders. ואם הם לא יחושו, and if they will not do something about it, rebuke them either, העונש מוטל על כולם ומידם, מידם יבוקש בלי ספק. So, רבי יצחק הרמה says, which is fascinating in terms of policy, public policy, basically he says, look, he says, we have a responsibility, we, the courts, the Jewish courts, we have responsibilities that in our societies, in our communities, inappropriate things, we should obviously try to prevent them, but definitely we cannot allow them to go out in the public. There is one thing to address an issue with an individual that has issues, problems, challenges, inclinations, whatever it is. You can address him, and you know what? Sometimes one-on-one, the rabbi can and maybe should, or maybe obligated, whatever the option is, to be lenient with that person. But that person takes this heter, this permission, and implements it in his own, his or her private life. That's it. But as a court to come and to say publicly that an inappropriate behavior, or alternatively a prohibition, is allowed, because of whatever consideration, it is not allowed. That's what Rabbi Yitzchak Arama claimed.
Did he succeed?
Did he succeed? I don't have enough information. I can tell you that based on what he said, that he talked to those people for many times, it seems to be that he definitely didn't succeed at the first time, not second time, not third time. I would assume that he was not so successful. I think it just came to an end at the expulsion of Jews from Spain. Okay, so I think the Goyim did his job instead of him doing his own job. But definitely, I think that issues like that, look, sometimes even when a darshan wants to do something, or even sometimes even posek, you can have all the good intentions in mind, but if the people are not ready to hear you, you can talk from now until tomorrow. So that's the issue of Rabbi Yitzchak Arama. I want to show you now a totally different perspective by the Rambam. The Rambam lived in the 12th century, obviously before Rabbi Yitzchak Arama, and in Shuta Rambam, which is fascinating because you will see the differences. In Shuta Rambam, Siman Resh Yud Aleph, he says the following, She'ela. What was the question? Now, the Rambam, don't forget, just one thing, the Rambam, unlike Rabbi Yitzchak Arama, is not a darshan. He's not a darshan. He's a posek. He's a halachist, he's a talmudist, he's a philosopher, but he's not a darshan. So he was asked the following question. Se she'ela. Ma yomar Adoneinu? What the Rambam has to say about dvar bachur, a young man, Jewish man, שקנה שפחה יפה תואר. He bought a maid servant, beautiful maid servant, stunning. והיא אצלו בחצרו. And she lives in his yard. והחצר גדולה. And it's a big yard. והודר עם אשת אביו. He lives with the mother, the wife of his father. It's not his mother. Meaning his mother probably died or she's not there. So he lives with his father and the wife of his father, ושלוש בנותיה הקטנות, and his father has with this new wife, three little daughters, נפלו דין ודברים בינו ובין אחיו. But then what happened was that this guy who bought this beautiful maiden had some fights with his brother. תבאו האח אל השופט ויראו ביניהם דין ודברים הרבה. אחר כך הלשין אחיו אותו אל השופט שקנה שפחה נוצריה וגיירה והוא מתייחד עימה. אוקיי, so what do we have here? What do we have here? What's the problem? So let's give them names. Okay, Reuven, I hope no one here's name is Reuven, okay? But Reuven is a young boy, probably a pretty wealthy guy. He lives with his father. His mother died, and his father lives with a wife, and they have three daughters. Okay, he bought a beautiful Christian man, and she lives with him. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me? No.
Yes, we can.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
You can. Okay.
Yes.
So she's in the yard. Okay. So I think there is some issues also here with the internet. But okay, so you just raise your hand when you can't hear me. So the thing is that this Reuven has a brother, Shimon, and you know, I guess they have a little fight, and then Shimon takes Reuven to the Beidin. Okay, he takes him to the Beidin, and then he said, you know what, I'm going to tell this Beidin something about my brother, about Reuven. And he says to them, Reuven bought a Christian maidservant, and he lived with her. She lives with him in the yard, in the backyard or in the front yard, and he converted her. So why does he say that? I mean, what does this have anything to do with what they are talking about? Answer is, he wants to basically throw dirt on Reuven. He wants to say something to the Beidin in order to ruin his reputation. Only brothers can do that, right? Only brothers can do that. So then the story doesn't end there. Ba shifcha lifnei ha-shofet, so the maidservant comes in front of the judge. Veshala ha-shofet, mahi. So the shofet asked her, what are you? Are you Christian? Are you Jew? Behave so Jewishly. And the judge asked her, what are you? Amra Yehudia, I'm a Jew. הציעה לה הפשעות. So he told her, you know what, maybe you want to leave Christianity and become a Muslim woman. וסרבה, and she refused. ואמרה, אני יהודיה, בת יהודיה אני. I'm a Jew, a daughter of a Jew. Interesting. We said that she was Christian. But she said, I'm a Jew, a daughter of a Jew. החזיר אותה לו השופט ולקחה לביתו. So the judge told her, okay, you can go with Reuven. And Reuven took her to his house. ורננה עליו העיר, והיא עכשיו נשארה בביתו. So she is now not in the yard, but she is with him in the house. So the question is, האם צריכים בית דין? Is the Jewish court needs to להוציאה מביתו משום ייחוד? Does he need to take her out because of ייחוד? אף על פי שלא יתייחד עימה, משום שנאמר, ויתם נקיים מהשם ומישראל, או נאמר, משום שאשת אביו אמו בחצר, איננו חייבים להוציאה מאצלו. ואם בית דין צריכים להוציאה, מאיזה טעם תהיה הוצאתה? לפי שלא מצינו שאסרו אלה איחוד פנויה ואיחוד בגויה. ומאיזה טעם נאסור ישיבתה בביתו? ואם לדין יפה תואר, אם לאו יורנו רבנו בשכרו כפול מן השמיים. Very complicated question, which I will be honest, some details are missing. But this Reuven again bought a Christian maidservant. He put her in the yard. Okay. He lives with his father and the wife of his father and three daughters. He goes to court. The brothers sue him. The judge, who was probably, in my opinion, was a Muslim judge, he asked her, do you want to convert to Islam? And she said, no, I'm a Jew. I want to be a Jew. And the judge says to her, you can go back with Reuven. He takes her to his house. They are not married. This single guy bought a beautiful maidservant. You ask me what for, what for, what purposes? I don't know, but he bought her. And that was, by the way, a pretty common practice in the time of the Rambam. And then the question is he allowed to be with her in the same house? Why? Because of Yichud. Or you say, because his father's wife is there and the three daughters, it's okay, there is no Yichud. So that was the question. The Rambam gives a very interesting answer. The Rambam says, "Atshuva ein la din yafat Torah, lefi shezot nityachda bedin Torah, mishum shehutar likha." Leisha, באותה עת, רצה לומר בעת הכיבוש שהיא בגיוטה, מפני שלא דיברה תורה אלא כנגד יצרו, כמו שהותר להם באותה עת לאכול האיסורים ובתים מלאים כל טוב, אפילו קד לדה חזירי, ואין להקיש על זה. וצריכים בית דין אחר הזאת השמועה אשר לא טובה, לכפותו להוציאה, או ישחררה ויסענה לאישה. He says, look, she's not like אשת יפת תואר, this Christian maidservant. The bait din needs to intervene and to say to him, look, let her go, or get married with her. אף על פי שיש בזה כאין עבירה, לפי שהנטען על השפחה ונשתחררה, אסור לו להישען עליך תחילה. He says, the problem is, if we tell him to marry that girl, we have a problem. Why? Because there is a sugya of הנטען על השפחה. What is נטען על השפחה? The Gemara already talked about a Jew who bought a maidservant, and there are rumors that he has sexual relationships with her. And we say we don't allow him to marry her. Why? Because then we say, הנטען על השפחה ושחררה, and he let her go. It was only to let her go so he can marry her, but we don't want it. So that's why we say you can't marry her. So he says, perhaps here is the same case. Says the Rambam, לפי שכבר פסקנו פעמים אחדות בכגון אלו המקרים. Look what he says. He says, כבר פסקנו פעמים אחדות. We already made our decision clear in other cases. שישחררה וישענה. And take a look at the reason. ועשינו זאת מפני תקנת השווים, ואמרנו מוטב שיוכל רוטב ולא שומן עצמו. ושמחנו על דבריהם, עת לעשות להשם הפרו תורתך. ומסייעים לו להישענה בעדינות ברוך. We help him to marry her. ויקבעו...
Sound is gone.
And they will set the time for him להישענה או להוציאה, כמו שעשה הזריג. Can you hear me?
Off and on.
No. No.
The last sentence.
Yes.
Okay. So I will... Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Okay. So I will use the 3 minutes that you can hear me, and I will say to you the following. The Rambam said, we need to tell him, let her go or get married with her. But to get married with her, he took her as Christian girl. He converted her. He was with her before they got married. And now we are telling him to marry her. Why? Answer, because we know that he cannot really control himself. And it's better for him to violate a little thing of Nit'an al-Shifcha. And basically allow him to be with her in a kosher. I have my phone with me here with the internet, so I don't know. Can you hear me now?
Now, yes.
Yes. Okay. So the Rambam says
punchline.
The punchline is like that. The punchline is, the Rambam says when an individual does something that is half wrong, but you can fix it, even though you help him to violate something that it's not appropriate, do it. Now, the Rambam said it with an individual, but it was not an individual because the Rambam says, I already gave that psak few times. Now, what does it mean, few times? I don't know, 10, 2, 20, which means, I think according to the Rambam, the idea of rabbinic intervention is not like what Rabbi Yitzchak Arama says in Spain, you know what, let's all of us get butchered, but we're not going to omit anything from the Torah. The Rambam, who was much more practical, said, no, we don't do that, especially with individuals. If we can somehow allow someone to do something, even though on the way he or she violates something small, mm-hmm. we should do it. So basically what I want all of you to think about, and we will continue next time, Bezrat Hashem, is, can you hear me now? Because this is really the most important thing. Yes. Is that what we saw a clash between how do you form public policies when a violation of a negative prohibition is involved, which is so important. Do you look at the needs of the community right here, right now? Or you say, look, we as a community cannot fund, support, and accept any violation on the public arena. On the private arena, we might address it in a more lenient way. But when it comes to the public arena, we need to be very stringent. Or we say, no. Part of the idea is, yes, I understand. Everyone knows that this Reuven took this Christie for a maidservant and made her Jewish so he can marry her. I understand it, but you know what? I don't care. You know why I don't care? Because if we're not going to allow him or to even encourage him to marry her, he will buy more maidservants like that. He doesn't care. But the fact that he doesn't care doesn't mean we don't care. We as a Beit Din need to intervene and to help him out, to bring him back to the path of Judaism and not to remove him. And by the way, this is a sign and a reflection of the huge separation in mindset of the poskim from the East and the poskim from Ashkenaz, which part of their mentality was formed because of the circumstances that each one of them obviously lived in. Does anyone have any questions?
Fast question. Would the children be Jewish?
Sure. There is no question about the conversion. There are questions about the motives of the conversion. But
the conversion is so she's yes. Jewish, the children are Jewish.
Yeah. But there are no children here yet. I mean, but you're asking in the future. Yes. Okay, you know what? I'm not going to test my luck with the internet. Next time I'll try to get a place with a better internet. So I apologize for that. Everyone keep safe and healthy. I'll see many of you, I think, tonight at the 8 p.m. class. So until then, have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next session is the 10:30, right?
Correct.
Yeah, you're right.
So you have a half hour break, almost.
Time for a bagel.